Hey guys, hope everyone out there is having a fantastic day today. First, I want to give a huge shout out to our Patreon supporters. Without you guys, this interview would not have been possible. And I mean, literally would not have been possible because, well, you can't do a good interview without a microphone. And so thanks to our Patreon supporters, I was able to go and pick up a great mic for this interview and other future interviews. Well, guys, we are finally here. After 2 months of editing and getting this thing ready for you, we are finally here with our in-depth, exclusive interview with film composer and our friend, Lauren Balf. Now, this interview is a little bit over an hour, but please stay for the whole thing if you can. We talk a lot about his career, how he got started scoring games, TV, and transitioning into films, his work and friendship with one of the greats, Hans Zimmer, his mentors. We talk a lot about his newest film score to Mission Impossible Fallout and working closely with Tom Cruise and Christopher McQuarrie. And he also takes some questions from our viewers. Lauren is just a real good down-to-earth dude, and we had a ton of fun talking and had some good laughs along the way as well. Real quick, before we get into the interview, stay tuned after this video for a big announcement we have. Alrighty guys, time to get into what you came here for. So without further ado, here is our exclusive interview with film composer Lauren Balf. Hey everyone, thanks for tuning in to Twin Flicks, a film channel for film lovers like yourself. Today we have a very special guest, film composer Lauren Balf has joined us, and today we're going to talk about his career and about his newest film, Mission Impossible Fallout. So first I want to say thank you so much for taking time out of your very busy schedule to talk with us this morning.
It's my absolute pleasure, Paul. Lovely talking to you.
I was doing some research, and I found out that you actually hail from Scotland, correct?
I absolutely do.
Do you still live there?
Family's still there. But, no, unfortunately, with the nature of the beast, the industry is mainly not in Scotland, unfortunately, for me. So I had to part ways, and I moved to London, and then I moved to Los Angeles.
Okay, so it was composing music something you always wanted to do, something you always wanted to get into?
Probably. I never thought of it as a job. I never thought music was an actual job. I was surrounded by it. My father was a composer and a songwriter, and he had a studio, and I was just constantly surrounded by musicians and studios, and that was my life. So I don't think I ever kind of thought of it as a job. It was just something that everybody did, that everybody enjoyed. So it was music was just a path I really enjoyed. And then I think the whole film composing thing happened on a different journey. I started off doing commercials, and then that led into TV shows, and then video games, and then film. So it was that kind of evolution, really.
Okay. So it was kind of in the blood. It's ingrained in you, then.
It's as thick as mud in me. Thick as mud.
Basically, since you were basically raised around music and composing music and so forth,
So is that something you thought was kind of like, it was just normal to you, correct?
Yes, to me it was. I think it was just, I always thought of it as a career, which I don't think it really, I think in the real world, you realize it's not really. It's like actors, it's only a few of you ever get work, and it's a hard business. I think I had been told by my career advisor at school that the only job in music was being a teacher, a music teacher, and that was it.
Oh, wow.
And I think when I was at school, I knew that I loved commercial music and I loved pop music, and then I think I started discovering film music. And so it started when I was 16, 17, when I started being aware of what this music was. I don't think it was as famous as it is now. I think the concept of a film composer, everybody knows Hans Zimmer and everybody knows John Williams, but I think when I was young, I don't think people really did.
Yeah, you know, when Simon and I, when we were younger, we used to love, I remember we were 13 years old, and we loved film scores. Our first soundtrack was Star Trek II, James Horner composed. And then we did, and then our next soundtrack was Batman with Danny Elfman. And
yes,
we just started, I mean, even if we didn't see the movie, even if we didn't like the movie, if it was composed by, you know, James Horner, Alan Silvestri, James Newton Howard, John Williams, Danny Elfman, we bought the score, and it was always looked at, if you were a lover of film music, you were kind of looked at as the outsider or the nerd, and now today it's so much different. Well, scores have...
I think we're still the nerds, unfortunately. I think and but the good thing, the difference is that nerd, you can embrace the nerdship now. We've got nothing to be ashamed of.
Exactly. I mean, it's blown up and become more and more popular. I mean, I talk to people all the time now who actually know who these composers are that I used to talk about when I was a kid. And
yes,
you know, why do you think there's been such a resurgence in film scores today?
I think it's just the natural evolution of music. I think film music is what opera music was. It's the same. I think it's the same story being told. It's a performance, and I think that the concert music has decreased. So the next development of concert music really has been film or game music. I think game music is in the same path. I think game music used to be very looked down on and used to be regarded as inferior, which is the exact opposite now. It was at the time a ridiculous connotation, but I think that what's happened is that people have realized that game music is amazing, and there's great composers, and I think film music also, now that there's a bigger thirst for discovering new types of music. So I think it's just the next platform.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Because I know I've noticed that more and more composers have started doing more concerts. That was unheard of. You know, maybe John Williams once in a while, but now it's become more and more common.
I think the concept of concert music is not, you're not necessarily getting the same type of the contemporary concert music is the opposite to the likes of the other repertoire, which is Wagner or Beethoven or Puccini. Mm-hmm. It's totally different. The media, the yearning for media music is just has increased, because I think there's a wanting for actual melody.
Going back to film score, when did you realize that that's what you wanted to really do, is get into scoring films? I mean, did you have a moment that hit you, like, this is what I want to do?
I don't think I ever had a moment. I think I always remember listening to Wall Street and being blown away by Stuart Copeland's score, because I just couldn't tell what was music and I couldn't tell which was sound effects. It was an amazing wall of sound that just got me very excited, and I loved music like bands like The Art of Noise and Depeche Mode, and I loved weird noises, and I wasn't classically trained, so the kind of the classical world of writing for orchestra really kind of came later in my development. So I was just kind of fascinated by songs, but Wall Street was something that just got me very excited, and then I know many say it, but like The Lion King, I loved musicals, but I was watching something that had great songs, and there was this music in the middle of it, which I didn't understand what it was, and it was interesting. So those films, and of course being a Star Wars freak, I was always aware of, I remember owning the vinyl of Return of the Jedi and listening to, on loop, the Ewok song for the village at the end.
Oh.
There was those were little clues, and then it just started evolving, and then I think I started becoming more aware of it, and then some of my favorite films like Psycho and the works of Bernard Herrmann, I was just like, gosh, it's really interesting how music can set a tone and tell a story. So there was no light bulb moment. It was just a long journey, and it's still happening. This is one of the great things about movies and films and games. It's all of a sudden you watch something and it works, and it makes you excited. And you can relate to it and enjoy it. So I think it's just a constant thing.
Obviously, you've worked with Hans Zimmer, who's clearly become one of the most, if not sought-after, composer. How did you get involved with Hans Zimmer?
I got involved with Hans by... I worked with quite a few of his protégés. I'd worked with them... Rupert Gregson-Williams, I'd worked with Henning Lohner, and I was just around. I was working at his studio, but for a few other composers, and then one day, I think it was the first film I ever worked with him on was Batman Begins. And I started arranging and writing for him then. So it was 15 years ago. It sounds a long time, and we still work together now. We just finished the new FIFA theme, which was on during the World Cup. So we still work together, and I learned a lot. But it was just that lucky moment where I was given that opportunity to work for him, and I took it. I didn't actually know what the equipment was I was meant to work on, and I said, yes, I can do it, and I had no clue how to do it, so I was awake all night, frantically learning how to use the software, and thankfully I learned how to get it working, and I kept my job.
Well, it's like, what are you going to say, no?
Well, yeah, many people do, and I've given that opportunity to people in my career now, where they've turned around and said, "No, or I don't know." I suppose you'll never know what opportunities could have happened in life. But I had that belief in life where you always say yes and then deal with the complications afterwards.
Many composers today with their film scores, they tend to sound the same as their last score they did. How do you maintain your signature style while also keeping it fresh and original?
I'm still learning that question. I'm still learning that one, Paul. I think it's very difficult, and I think that what I try to do is do a different project. I try not to do the same show or the same film straight after another, because I think then you do go down the path of how do you reinvent this. So I've always tried to kind of move around. So before Mission Impossible, I was doing Genius and about Picasso, and you know, which is just totally the opposite. So I just try. I tried different genres, and I tried different ways that I can help musically tell this story. And I think if you're always trying to kind of reinvent yourself, if you're trying to, I think it can become exhausting. And I think what's interesting about, I made a really great songwriters and composers, I think those who don't naturally try hard, it may come more naturally.
Switching around to different genres, and you know, like you said, like Genius was a TV project compared to film. As far as that, what's the difference, if any, between composing, say, like a TV show like Genius compared to a film like Mission Impossible?
I always say it's the same. When somebody says, "What's the difference between a film and a game or a TV show?" I never feel that there's any difference. The only difference is the amount of minutes of music you've got to write. That's it. I think that's the whole task in hand is the same thing. You've got the same objective. You've got the same task. You're trying to thematically connect us musically with the characters and help the audience connect to them. So it's the same. It's the same. You have the same mission and the same journey throughout the whole film or TV show. So it really is the same. It's just a different duration.
Now, I've always been curious, since TV shows are usually about 40 minutes, 45 minutes an episode, do you compose each episode separately, or do you do just one long composition and then the editors kind of edit it with the show length?
It depends. Depends on the project, and I think it also depends on the time allocation. Sometimes you can have 4 days to do an episode, and I think that I think each situation is different. But I what you try to do is unlike a film where you can sit back and ask, you can see the beginning to the end when you start composing. With TV, you can't see the end, because you've probably got another 10 hours until you find out what actually happens. And like with the show Marcella, that's on Netflix, I'll never read the script. And the first thing I do is, when going through each episode, is I don't know what the next episode is. So when it comes to the end and you find out, A, who the killer is or what's happened, it's a shock to me. So I try to, with that show, for example, try to write with the audience in mind and keep that into, the context of the storytelling. And sometimes you can't, you always write your themes and your character themes, and so everybody agrees with that. Because also with TV shows, you've got different directors for every episode, you have different editors for every episode, so it's more complicated with the amount of people, but by getting your toolkit set in stone at the beginning, it helps you be covered. But the answer is basically there's no one example. Sometimes you write a lot and the music that you're writing in one can be used in episode 8, or sometimes you just simply have to write the whole episode because none of the music from the prior episode works.
Okay, that's interesting, yeah. Let's go ahead and get into your newest film, Mission Impossible Fallout.
Yes.
Christopher McQuarrie did just an amazing job with that film. And,
didn't he just?
Oh, man. And I actually listened to your score before I saw the movie. And I was just blown away by your score, first of all. And then it elevated the movie even more. So I noticed that the score to Mission Impossible Fallout actually sounds different, very different from the previous films. How did you come up with that particular sound for that score?
You know, weirdly, I feel that it's a very Mission score because all the thematic material of it is all very related to Lalo's original main theme and his plotting theme. So the DNA is all there. Even our two-note baddie motif, the bomb, bomb, that is all in the plotting theme. And I know that the time signature of it, the 5-4, that's, I know that, you know, somebody was on Twitter saying to me it sounded like this movie and sounded like that movie. Unfortunately, it was written in 1960, so it's, you know, unless somebody's got in a time machine and changed history, it's, Lalo had created all this great DNA, and it was sitting there, and it is just a darker movie. And the storytelling is much darker, and I think that allowed the music to change, and I think that it's always a difficult thing when you have a franchise because I think people always feel that you just want the same again, but it's a different movie and it's a different tone, and Chris and Tom wanted a different and fresher approach to the score, and I think that I tried to treat it as if that melody had been written today, and this is what you do with it, instead of trying to do a parody of it or a pastiche of it. It's a fantastic melody. It's a melody well known all over the world, and I think that I just tried to kind of treat it as if that melody had been written for this movie, and how do we then make it work?
Did you watch a rough cut before actually scoring the film, or, I mean, how much time did you have to write the score itself?
A long time. I was very fortunate in being able to have my writing room right next to the editing room.
Oh, that helps.
So it was really amazing to be able to be sitting next door to Chris and Eddie Hamilton. And constantly experimenting, so there was a good solid four months of that, and then I was writing 4 months prior to that, based on really the conversations that I'd had with Chris when we were first meeting up and having breakfast and talking about the movie. It was really there was a seed planted in my head, and I just thought, and I just started kind of thinking of ideas. So then I started sending them to him. And the unique thing about Chris is that he never tempts with temp music. He never puts external music into it. So,
oh, really?
So it meant there was no pressure there. And then if music that I was writing that was not necessary to a particular scene, but through a conversation, he was then able to experiment with it and try it in different scenes.
Yeah, so I know, of course, in the film, Chris McCrory did tie in all the previous films ahead of it that the other ones didn't always do, or do successfully. So was that always in the conversation about we want also the score to help tie in the previous films? Or were you working on this mainly as a standalone score for the film?
I think all of the films have related to the TV show. Instead of doing something that was just a parody to the TV show, it was to try to make it more relevant to this actual movie. And that's why it was a case of, instead of constantly just doing the whole theme, it was taking three notes and using that. And the same as just using the pulse. There was no conscious kind of plan to throw all the bathwater out, say.
Yeah, actually, sir, I actually rewatched some of the episodes of the old show last week, and I'm like, wait a minute, that's the same cue that Lorne Balfe used in Fallout, and it's just really cool how you can go back to a show, like you said, you know, it's in the 60s, and still hear the same themes in these new movies.
Yeah, but you know, it's the same as if the Beatles wrote great songs, and they're timeless. A good song is a good song.
Yeah.
It's not gonna pass away. And it's the same with a theme. Once there's a good solid theme, you use it. It's part of when I hear that theme, I see Ethan Hunt, and Tom Cruise is Ethan Hunt. So it helps the story, and it helps us all feel connected more to Ethan Hunt.
Exactly. So, you know, they say scores can completely elevate a film to another level. And honestly, I felt your score did that completely with Fallout. Within the score itself, what would you say is a couple of your favorite tracks of that score?
Well, favorite tracks. I can tell you favorite scenes. I think that the whole opening, which is the opening of the soundtrack.
A Storm Is Coming?
Yes, that is it. I think to me, you know, making the soundtrack is another complicated thing, because you don't necessarily want to, you can either make it in one running order, or you can make it an actual enjoyable listening experience. And I think that with that one track, it starts off with the beginning of the movie, but then it actually then goes to a cue from near the end. And I just wanted that piece of music to represent the movie and the film and the experience that you're going to listen to. So the bongos at the beginning of the logos, you know, watching the logos of a movie is why I get excited with movies. When you hear that piece of music coming in over the opening logos, it gets you excited, and it tells you what you're about to experience. So writing the opening, the Mission Impossible movie, it's very exciting. And also, I think using the bongos, which again goes back to the TV show. It's that colour that was used very frequently, and instead of just simply having one bongo player, I wanted to experiment with different ways of playing it, with bamboo sticks and drumsticks and then different sections. So sometimes in the score it goes to a solo bongo player, and then it'll go to 12 of them, so it's just changing colours constantly. So the first track is important to me. I think the final track, the mission accomplished, which is the end credits. I've been a fan of Mission Impossible for like 22 years. It's been a long journey. So being given permission to be able to use this theme and do something with it was just a lot of fun. So and also having a choir singing Mission Impossible in Latin, you can't go wrong with that. So that was a dream come true. But then I think a complicated scene was Should You Choose to Accept. That was a difficult scene, which is the mission cue. I always look at them as kind of when I hear it, I have a memory of how it was written. So it's very hard to kind of choose favorite ones. It's like choosing a favorite child. One doesn't want to do that because it's a bit unfair. recording Stairs and Rooftops was just a lot of fun, and with these amazing musicians, it's just always a joy to be able to work with them. And also you're watching a fantastic action sequence with Tom Cruise jumping over roofs, and it's real stunts, and it's just amazing.
I know that there's a single disc of the score, the soundtrack, out, but I also know, I think there's a deluxe edition coming out with bonus tracks.
Yes.
I'm not sure, how many extra tracks are going to be on that, do you know?
It's going to be a double CD, and there's, I believe, five or six bonus cues. I think it's been a fun score to write, because I think that very rarely in life do you get shots with a helicopter with Tom Cruise hanging off a rope. It's very rare. So and being able to write large and small sections, it's just been a joy to write.
And talking about that, when you see a film, and you can tell the director and the actors had a lot of fun making the film, it's more enjoyable to watch. And when you listen to your score, it literally sounds like you're having so much fun with the score. And I mean, you can just hear how much fun you're having with the score through the music.
That's the joy of this job, really, is to. How I treat film music is that when I close my eyes and I hear it, I vision what's going on, or I can imagine what's going on. So I think with this movie, it's especially being able to use that famous plotting theme from the TV show during the end for the helicopter. There's a great payoff, and it's a great theme, and. I don't think that anybody had used it the way that we were using it, where it was just so majestic and proud. So it was a great joy.
Well, we can get us to a few questions from some viewers.
Go for it.
Let's see here. Let's see here. Marfa Cat 2793 from Spain writes, what composers influence you the most when scoring a film?
Depends on the film. I think, yeah, that's how I look at it. I think that when I was working on the first show, Genius, which was on Einstein, a lot of influences were very classical based. With Picasso, he had his. You had a lot of Spanish music, which was a massive influence to him. You also had a lot of contemporary classical music, which was an influence. Folk music. So every single project is a different experience. I think in my DNA, I know that there are composers that are always part of it, and Vaughan Williams is a big influence to me. The fact that I'm Scottish, I feel that a lot of Celtic music, even though you don't hear it, but the structure of how I write melodies, I've always felt is very part of how I structure pieces, and the fact that I was a failed percussionist at college, the fact that I write very rhythmically and very pattern based is a massive influence, and I think that I think also, you know, I having worked for Hans, I picked up a lot from him, and the same with Rupert Grayson Williams. I just learned a lot, and I think, but I never when I start a project automatically channel a thought. It's really just different, and especially with Mission, I always had Lalo in the background of my life, basically, because that he is the maestro when it comes to Mission Impossible.
See, Marfa Cat also writes, Tom Cruise, also being a producer on the film, was he involved, if at all, on a particular sound he wanted for the score, or was it all Christopher McQuarrie?
Absolutely, Tom was involved. He's not just the main star. He's a producer, and when we listen to that Mission Impossible music, that theme is his. He is Ethan Hunt. I don't think there's been a melody associated with one individual as strongly as with Tom. So, and he knows the world of Mission. So Tom was he had great advice and great ideas of how to use the melody, and during the whole bike Paris scene, there was a few spots there where he wanted to kind of inject more fun musically into it. And then the same with the helicopter ride, raising the stakes. So he's very part of the whole filmmaking process and the film music process.
That's interesting. You don't get that from very many actors or of his caliber. Usually they do the film and that's it. But
absolutely. But he's one of a kind, though. He really is. He's a true professional, and it's rare to find people that are so committed with what they're making. And many people just kind of aren't fully invested in it, but he truly is.
His worth ethic is just incredible. What he goes through for a film.
He lives and breathes it. And that is something that cannot be said with. I just realized something. Where's your? I thought there was two of you on the show.
Well, actually, Simon is not here right now.
I know that.
Yeah. Well, obviously, though. He's not here right now.
I just thought for the last 40 minutes he'd been silent, sitting there.
Yeah. No. No. He actually had a doctor's appointment. He had to go to the. He completely forgot about. So I. Took the reins. Yeah, unfortunately.
Shame on him. Yeah. Shame on Simon.
Yeah, you wish that he could be here. He was like, oh, crap, no. But, yeah, he tried to...
Your health is more important there, so...
I don't know. Yeah, he wishes he could be here. He's here in spirit. He's here in spirit.
Good.
Yeah, our next question is from Dylan Brown, and he's from Australia. And he asks, what did you look to for as a reference when approaching the Fallout score? I guess that kind of ties in with the
last
question.
Answered it. The Mission Impossible TV show.
Yeah.
I think, and the fact that, and the movie, that's where you have to get your inspiration from. I think that when you watch it, it was interesting to, I did a commentary, for the movie about the music. So that'll be coming out. So it's the full movie and I'm talking a lot, too much probably, about the whole process, and I think that the major thing was that fact there was no temp, but yet the temp really had been created because we had these great melodies from the TV show, so you can always go back to that. So that's the inspiration, but the main inspiration is I think comes from Chris and Tom. And what they've created.
Yeah. Well, that's really going back to where you said you did a commentary for the Blu-ray.
Yeah,
that's interesting. You don't get that from composers.
After you've listened to it, you'll understand why.
Well, for film fans, film score fans like us, that's something that I've actually always wanted to hear. Was a real commentary from the composer, but yeah. So
well,
I'm actually
you'll get it. It's the full one. But I think also it's talking about how some of the scenes I had done differently and different approaches. Like the whole opening originally, I didn't have bongos. It was a different piece of music. So there's a lot of talk about that and talking about the musicians that appeared in it. And the whole music team, just talking about them, because they always get forgotten about, unfortunately, and they shouldn't do.
Yeah, that kind of stuff is very interesting to myself and my brother Simon, and you know, just film lovers in general. Yeah, so wow, now I can't wait to hear that.
Good. Well, at least Simon can be part of that.
Yeah, exactly.
Good.
Let's see. So Arvid Black from Portland, Oregon. Writes, with your impressive list of films you've done, is there a particular genre you really want to tackle that you haven't done yet?
Probably horror, but I haven't really done horror because I don't quite know what to do with it. It's musically. When I watch Paranormal Activity, I'm petrified, and there's no music in it. So I think it's a case of just trying to find the right type of horror film to work on. It's difficult, because I think that when Scream came out, I think Scream embraced musically every trick in the bag with how to try to manipulate the audience, and it killed it. It just, in a good way, it just said you can no longer do any of these tricks. And it's just very difficult with doing that. You either end up in a sound design world or a very atonal score. I would have any ideas with how to do that genre, really. Never say never, though, but...
Yeah, I guess that's true. Marco Beltrami kind of pulled every trick out of the bag for that score. Now that you mention it, when I think back on the score,
they're great tricks, and I'm not saying tricks in like a kind of a cheap way. It gave permission because the whole thing was about excessiveness to do with building tension and it was just done so cleverly, but it meant you can no longer use those techniques any longer. So it's a difficult one. But then again, you get great films like Hannibal, which is a very dark movie, but when Hans turned it into something that was romantic, it was just a total twist, and it was amazingly clever. So I think, yeah.
Exactly. Let's see. A couple more questions here. actual real Jake from California. He says he actually has two questions here.
Okay.
We'll take the first one first. We'll go easy.
Yeah, do the first. One minute of time.
Let's see here. It says what has been your favorite. He says, what has been your favorite work so far? I'm assuming he's asking what has been your favorite score so far that you've conducted.
I can't say I have a favorite that goes back to kind of the choosing the favorite child.
Yeah.
It's a very difficult one because I think you're never fully content with what you've done. Well, at least I struggle with it because of time difference. You know, there's a you don't have enough time, or you don't. You know, there's always a reason. So it's very difficult to kind of look back at it and go, that's perfection. It's there's always something. I know that on this movie I've had a lot of fun, and I'm very proud of it. But it's a difficult one, I think, to say what your best work is, because I try to distance myself from it.
Yeah. Is it difficult to, I mean, of course, you're the one writing the score, you're composing it, and you're working with the production team and everything, and so is it hard to disconnect yourself from how much fun you had composing it compared to how much hearing the actual score itself?
No, I think that it's I don't know. I think that there's always the what if feeling, and I think that that's how I look at it. There's always a feeling of, oh gosh, I could have done that, or I could have tried this, and so when you kind of look back at it, you kind of get a tad frustrated. I'm sure some composers just go, gosh, no, what I did was fantastic, and I love it. But I find that a bit hard to do that. But on the other hand, I do look at projects and remember, I have great memories. That's a different thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, going to write Batman Lego in Australia was a fantastic experience. And working on Dunkirk with Chris Nolan was a great experience. And learning so much on Fallout with Chris, I've learned so much about filmmaking. So I have great memories, but choosing my favorite musical pieces, I struggle with.
Yeah, I can understand that. I mean, Simon and I we've dabbled in filmmaking and short films and so on, and we've worked on some productions. It's hard. I mean, you can never really say this is my favorite or that's my favorite, because like you said, it's like choosing who's your favorite child. You know, it's all your babies. And
you don't, at least I do, but I think the majority of composers I know, you sacrifice friends and relationships to write this music when you're working on projects, and you work 7 days a week. It's a long process.
Yeah.
And I think that you're fully invested in it, and it's not just something that just happens. You work hard at it, so it's very hard to kind of pick.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, his second question is, he asks, what is, in your opinion, the work that has influenced your style the most?
I think it goes back to the harmonic world of Vaughan Williams, but the kind of the production approach of Art of Noise and Depeche Mode, and there is no one work.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, you know, one of my favorite film scores is The Burbs by Jerry Goldsmith.
That's a great score, and
it's just amazing. Or the Goonies, you know, that's it's just amazing music. So there's no one piece that's been but I know there's a classical piece by Vaughan Williams called Donne Nobe Pacem, which is just, for some reason, I remember performing it at school, and and I always regularly listen to it, and it's just something that probably memory wise, but musically it's just a perfect piece of music. It's like The Lark Ascending. It's just something like that.
Okay. And our last question is from Timothy 58 Anderson from Texas. He writes here, what was it like to score a Mission Impossible film?
Dream come true.
Was it a surreal experience?
Yes, and I think as hard as I kept trying to kind of put that aside, because I knew if you have emotions like that, it's intimidating and you don't focus on the task in hand. But I would very regularly sit there and look at my team and just go, that's Tom Cruise. We're doing Mission Impossible. It's
that's incredible.
It's overwhelming, really, but it's just a real honor.
And Timothy says here, I want Mr. Balfe to know that his Mission Impossible score, I think, is one of his best.
Thank you very much. That's very kind. And that means a lot, because we really worked hard.
That's the end of the questions, so I want to thank everyone who sent in their questions. We are running out of time, but before we go, do you have any future projects you can tell us about?
So, no, I've started on another movie with a director that I've worked with before, which is very exciting. But I never talk about it until it's out. There's always a fear with the composers. So many things may happen or change. It's not like you're the actor, so I always keep quiet, unfortunately. I'm stumped.
That's understandable. But you do have a website and Facebook page. Fans can go to check out any updates that you have for.
Absolutely. My website, we're always trying to keep it updated with unreleased cues.
Okay.
So one thing that we're going through at the moment is going through prior projects and uploading the cues that just never made it onto the album. So it's a long job, but we're slowly trying to get there, and just because sometimes you just can't. You can't fit it all on, so that's something. Especially with the games, there's no way you can release so much music. So just slowly but surely, just trying to upload all the unreleased music.
Okay, yeah. So we'll be leaving the link to your website down below in the description of this video, so people can check it out.
Yeah,
we are out of time.
That's a shame.
Yeah. Do you want to continue?
Well, we can, if you got more questions.
Actually, Simon actually just came home. You want me to grab him real quick? See if he can...
Yes, do grab him, because come on. That was what I was missing out on.
Yeah, you know, Simon's the man. Let me grab him real quick. Hang on one second here. Well, it looks like I lied to you.
Oh!
Oh, man, I thought it was... I thought I heard a door open, and I thought it was him. Oh man, I ran out there. I'm like, Simon, where are you? He's not.
Damn, hey, damn Simon.
You know, there's always next time, right?
Exactly. In 8 months' time, we can touch base again.
Yeah, definitely. Do you have anything that you can suggest for aspiring composers out there of how to get their foot in the door?
Watch films. Make films your life. I think to me, don't be worrying about analyzing film music and studying it. I don't think that teaches anything. Study film and enjoy music, because I think that when you look at great composers like John Williams and Hans and Danny and all these amazing composers, they didn't go and study film music. They loved and some studied music, some didn't study music, but there was a passion for film, and I think that's the most important thing is to follow, just learn the craft about filmmaking as equally and learning the craft about studying actual music. So that's my only suggestion.
You also don't want to risk the point where you start imitating, start copying another composer's work.
Well, I regularly get told that I've done something like this, or I get told something like that, and it's I don't hear it sometimes. I have to go and, or I haven't even seen the film. So I think, or sometimes it's because I've written it, I've forgotten I'd written it. So it's a very difficult path. And I think that when you do start studying it, you do go down a certain path, and it's not necessarily a very creative path. And I say that from experience.
Honestly, when we, Simon and I were dabbling in filmmaking and so forth, I had one producer that kind of took us under his wing, and he said, you know, don't study Steven Spielberg as a director. You know, you study his films and study film, but don't study him of how he makes the film. Otherwise, like, you know, it's kind of like what you're saying. And you don't develop your own sense of style if you study someone else's style.
Yeah, I think, but it's the same with artists. I think you just have to, you can learn from them. But I think I'm still trying to find my voice, and I think that it's not something that happens very quickly. I think I've got a bit of a kind of a different approach, but I'm still on that journey myself, and it doesn't come automatically.
One question that I've always, actually Simon and I both have always wanted to ask a film composer.
Yeah.
What is it like being in that recording room with your orchestra, the director, the film on the, usually there's a film on the screen, correct, while you're composing to it?
Yes, 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 yes.
So
yes.
What is all that like, being surrounded by...
You know, I think for the first 30 seconds, you're very proud of yourself, and you rub your tummy and head at the same time. And then really the reality is it's very stressful. It's like being a director on a film set. There is a lot of pressure, and you're against the clock. And I think that there's a slight kind of romantic, vision of it. I can't say I find it stressful any longer, but there is an element of fear, that's for sure, because it's all of a sudden, it's becoming alive, and it can not always come out the way that you thought it, you had planned it to. So it's very stressful.
I can imagine. So what do you do to kind of push that stress away and just focus on your work? Focus on
you just have to, because it's the same way as that when you know you've got to compose a 10-minute action scene in one day. You can either spend half of the day panicking and going, oh God, I'm never going to get this done, or you can just simply start writing it. I think it's the same. It's the same as anything in life. Just get on with it.
Yeah, because
it's,
put on your...
it's yeah. You just have to grab the horns and go for it.
Yeah.
And I think it's the same with recording. Sometimes you've only got a day to record, and there's just no time for mistakes. And there's a sense of adrenaline. So yeah, it's not easy. And I think that's also another thing that separates great composers. You know, there's plenty of composers that can write great tunes, but they can't necessarily write to picture. And they can't, they're unable to deliver in that time, in that window. So there's many factors that come into it.
Is Mission Impossible Fallout, was that your largest orchestra set?
Yeah, very, very large, and for some moments very small and intimate, and then other moments very big. But yeah, a lot of musicians and a lot of singers, and so yes, it was definitely the largest I've ever worked with.
And what would you say? What's been your smallest?
Nearly every independent movie that I do.
So just yourself.
I think you know I've always tried when I was starting out to always get at least one musician on, but sometimes there are no budgets and you just can't do it, and people may complain that there's samples, but that's the way it is, and you can unfortunately that's the way of filmmaking, and there's not always budgets. So I always, even if there is a very small budget, I always try to at least get a quartet or a few players to perform on top of it to add life to it and bring, because I think without live musicians, as great as technology is, it's just dead. And I think that we need them to bring their performance to it. You know, every musician's got a different tone and a different attitude. It may be the same notes, but it's a different attitude that they bring.
Yeah. One thing that me and Simon notice, especially with Fallout score, is, you know, so many composers seem to use or rely on synthesizers. And one thing we notice is that we didn't hear synthesizers in the score at all. It was all just a full orchestra. And, I mean, it really brought us back to the old scores that we used to love, from John Williams, you know, James Horner, Alan Silvestri, where it felt like it was I want, in my words, a true film score.
You know? It's interesting, because I think some purists don't want electronics brought into the score, but I feel that if you that's like saying we shouldn't have ever progressed into color, we should have stuck into black and white movies. It's just a kind of a ridiculous concept. Filmmaking has changed. You're no longer watching movies with no dialogue. We're no longer watching in stereo. The process of filmmaking has evolved, and so should music. And of course, we can embrace the classics, but don't just live in the past where it's a case of, well, the good old days. I think that we have to use everything possible to help the movie. And there's personal taste. Some people don't like electronics, and some do. And I think that if that's personal taste, but it's what works for the movie is what's important. And you have to, the movie tells you what you're going to use. And Fallout is a beautiful looking movie. And that's why there is a mixture sometimes. You may not know that if there's synths or manipulated strings. And I think that's what makes it kind of fun and interesting.
No, exactly. Like you said, I think it depends on the film as well. Like you said, you know, something like the Mad Max Fury Road compared to a movie like Fallout. You know, it's a completely different type of score with a different type of film.
Yeah, and I think going back to genius and with Einstein, I knew that there was no point just making it a purely classical score, because visually you were going into his head and seeing how he was figuring out these equations. And just because it's a period piece, why can't I use a modern approach? I think the fact is that there shouldn't be rules, and if they are, then they should be broken.
No, exactly. And, you know, your score for that miniseries is, it works. It completely fits and works within the show. I guess we'll go ahead and end the interview here.
Perfect, Paul.
We are out of time, and gosh, man, I want to thank you so much for taking time out of your very busy schedule for talking with us today.
My absolute, I like the fact you said us, but it's only you, Paul. Simon is no longer on my Twitter feed. But it's my absolute pleasure, and it's been lovely talking to you.
Yeah, it's been great talking to you as well. Yeah, I mean we have to do this again, and next time definitely with Simon. I know he really kicks himself for missing this. Yeah, we've got to make it up to him.
yeah, we will.
All right.
But thank you, and thank you for everybody submitting questions also.
Everybody, this has been Lauren Balfe, film composer, TV composer, and video game composer. And if you haven't heard his music yet, definitely check it out. I'll be leaving in the description below. I'll be leaving a link to your website, and so everybody can check that out, and your updates for future projects and so forth. Yeah, all right. So we will talk to you again. All right. Thank you.
All right, Paul. Thank you so much. Thank you. Speak to you soon. Thanks. Bye-bye.
Well, guys, that's our interview with our friend and TV game film composer, Lauren Balfe. We hope you enjoyed it as much as we did. It was one of the best interviews I've done recently. And stay tuned, guys, because we have another exclusive interview with frontman to Filter. And now you can add film composer to his resume. Richard Patrick was on the phone. We talked about a lot of different things. He's also the brother of the T-1000 himself, Robert Patrick. So keep an eye out for that. It's actually only going to land on our Patreon only page. So only our Patreons will be able to see it, because it is an unedited and, believe me, an uncensored interview. If you haven't already, hit up our Patreon page, and if you can, sign up, support the channel. Even $1 gets you in to hear this exclusive interview and also early access to all of our other videos before it hits on YouTube. Well, I want to give a sincere thank you to Lauren Balfe for taking time out of his busy schedule to talk to us, and also to all of you out there. Without you, this interview wouldn't have been possible. And guys, if you want to check out on how to order the deluxe edition with 5 bonus tracks of Mission Impossible Fallout, I have the link down below in the description. And let me know, guys, what is your favorite soundtrack from Lauren Balfe? As always, guys, thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.